إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له. ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له. ونشهد أن سيدنا ومولانا محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى في القرآن المجيد والفرقان الحميد: أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم: ولا تقربوا الزنا إنه كان فاحشة وساء سبيلا. وقال تعالى: يا أيها النبي إذا جاءك المؤمنات يبايعنك على ألا يشركن بالله شيئا ولا يسرقن ولا يزنين ولا يقتلن أولادهن ولا يأتين ببهتان يفترينه بين أيديهن وأرجلهن ولا يعصينك في معروف فبايعهن واستغفر لهن الله إن الله غفور رحيم. وقال النبي صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم: لا يزني الزاني حين يزني وهو مؤمن، أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام. صدق الله مولانا العظيم وصدق رسوله النبي الكريم، ونحن على ذلك من الشاهدين والشاكرين، والحمد لله رب العالمين. Honorable ulama ikram, respected brothers and elders, in my previous Juma I spoke in great detail about the harms of music and its prohibition. To tie up the talk from where we stopped, one hadith of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which will make the focus of today's talk, al-ghina ruqyatu zina. Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, the one that will engage in music, singing and dancing, then this would arouse his lust and it will translate in the form of zina and fornication. Like in English they say, dancing is the vertical expression of your horizontal desire. We find Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that zina will become so common, as we've seen it brothers, it has become so common that illegitimate children today form part of our society. We have situations in schools where children of tender age are being molested. Allah alone knows what the future holds when zina, fornication, prostitution has become so common. The riwayat of Tirmidhi Sharif, second volume, my Nabi said, يَأْتِيَنَّ عَلَىٰ أُمَّتِي كَمَا أَتَىٰ عَلَىٰ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلِ. Every challenge that came upon Bani Israel will come upon my ummah. حَتَّىٰ إِنْ كَانَ مِنْهُمْ مَنْ أَتَىٰ أُمَّهُ عَلَانِيَا لَكَانَ فِي أُمَّتِي مَنْ يَصْنَعُ ذَلِكَ. If in the previous nations the act of incest took place, where a person slept with his mother, I quote the exact words of Nabi alayhi salam, if in Bani Israel a man made zina with his mother, believe it, O my sahaba, in this ummah also, a time will come where people will sleep and share the bed with their own mothers. But brothers, let me go one step ahead. One is that zina has become common. The irony of the whole thing is, in the form of AIDS, which is a result of the violation of the divine command of Allah, which will be accepted beyond religious grounds by all divine religions, that infidelity and immorality and sleeping with a woman outside wedlock is incorrect, it is unlawful. There are certain campaigns whose endeavor is to destigmatize. How can you destigmatize a sickness, a pandemic, an epidemic, which is the result of the violation of the command of Allah? In essence, destigmatizing a person who contracted this AIDS because of infidelity is tantamount to legalizing prostitution. And this is what is happening. One side, mankind at this stage hasn't yet taken its lesson. So many thousands are dying, and this is the clear prophecy of Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, that when zina will become common, Nabi alayhi salam said in the riwayat of Ibn Majah, wal awja'u allati, we are hearing yesterday's report, any person, we've become immune to hear 1 year child raped, 2 years old, a child has been raped, it has become part of society, you hear it and you carry it on. But if you analyze this, where has society come into? Have you become immune to hear such stories where a child at the age of 1 has been raped by her father? Is this something that you can imagine? In this so-called civilized, technologically advanced era, this is what is happening. We find the Nabi of Allah said, when zina will become common, Allah will inflict such sicknesses, such diseases, which was unheard of. وَالْأَوْجَاعُ الَّتِي لَمْ تَكُنْ مَضَتْ فِي أَسْلَافِهِمْ أَلَّذِينَ مَضَوْا. So one side there is an effort to destigmatize the person who is guilty of zina, because of which he has contracted AIDS. At the same time, you are stigmatizing the polygamist who enjoys a divine right, which is his prerogative afforded to him by Allah. In essence, mankind is at loggerheads with Allah. Allah said zina is haram. Men felt that Allah was restricting his freedom. In the form of AIDS, thousands are losing their lives. Man still doesn't want to curtail. Man still doesn't want to apply. So he institutes measures that have relation with strange women, but apply this measure and apply that measure. Brothers, logically speaking, we have never heard of a polygamist who is sleeping with four women, but legally, lawfully. That makes us understand that zina, or rather AIDS, is not contracted because you sleep with more than one woman, but rather it is sleeping with more than one woman outside your wedlock. You give me one example of a man who's married legally, lawfully to more than one wife, and alhamdulillah, it is correct. He maintains and conforms with the dictates of Shariat. He maintains equity and fairness. He has more than one spouse. You give me one example of such a man. That makes us understand it is not the aspect of sleeping with more than one woman, but rather it is the direct result of violating the command of Allah and sleeping with more than one woman outside wedlock. When we speak about polygamy, brothers, this is not the focus of my topic. The focus of my topic today is not fornication, but adultery. The minor difference between the two, as we all know, is fornication is when that bachelor and that spinster engage in unlawful relation. I am speaking today those married couples that are pursuing illicit relation. Allah alone knows, brothers, we have statistics. We are not speaking from anywhere. I have statistics where married couples come to me, Maulana, unfortunately I'm involved with this woman, I'm involved with that woman. If I may add on to that here, as we discuss, I will explain. I cannot see, as a man, Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَا تَرَكْتُ بَعْدِي فِتْنَةً أَضَرُّ عَلَى الرِّجَالِ مِنَ النِّسَى. O my Sahaba, I am passing away and I am leaving this world. I have not left behind a greater challenge for the males of my ummah than the fitna of women. فَاتَّقُوا الدُّنْيَا وَاتَّقُوا النِّسَى. Fear the temptations of this world. It's green, it is lush, it's striking, it's appealing. وَاتَّقُوا النِّسَى. And fear the temptations of women. فَإِنَّ أَوَّلَ فِتْنَةُ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلِ كَانَتْ فِي النِّسَى. Verily the decline of Bani Israel started in the fitna of women. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam says in the riwayat of Bukhari Sharif, first volume, under the tarjumatul bab, babu tarkil hayd as-sawm, ma ra'aytu min naqisati aqlin wa deenin adhhaba li lubbi ar-rajul al-hazim min ihdakunna. O my sahaba, I have not seen any person who can snatch the intelligence of an intellectual man, who can veil the sanity of a man like how one female can do. Oh my Sahaba, I have never seen what one female can do. It snatches the intelligence of a person. As men, as the Nabi of Allah says, we are weak. Allah has created us perhaps the weakest point. And brothers, let me tell you, wallah, I address this message first to myself. There are two things I have told my students repeatedly in madrasa, and I make mention of it here. There are two things in life. Don't even trust yourself, never mind the next man. There never comes a stage in your life where you have matured the challenge of woman. You're never old enough, you're never over with this challenge. Perhaps in relation, when you were a young child, the challenge was greater. You got married, the challenge is relatively less. But you never mature this challenge. This never comes to an end, it remains. In two things of life, don't ever trust yourself, never mind your brother. That very same friend with whom you're dating and you're going out visiting your wife and his wife. Allahu Akbar. The Nabi of Allah says, the youth will never enter Jannah. The youth will never enter Jannah. Let me mention those two things first. One is, of course, the aspect of woman. And the second is the aspect of money. No man is too pious when it comes to these two things. This is the weakness of man. I fail to comprehend, as a male in this nude environment, every man sitting here knows the proportion of his vulnerability when he exits from his house. Wallah, I fail to comprehend, and from an Islamic perspective, I cannot see any leeway, any concession for a doctor, professional person to employ within his surgery, within his office environment, young, charming, seductive woman to sit there close by. Allah alone knows where do these people come with such concessions in Shariat. The Nabi of Allah says, اتقوا مواضع التهمة. Avoid and a platform of accusation. Avoid a situation of accusation. Daily you sit in with strange girls who are under your employment, who are young. Some of them, without generalizing, have so loose morals that their smile is deliberate to jeopardize your marriage. Nadrun fabtisamun fakalamun famawidu. It is the lustful gaze which is translated into a smile, exchange of phone numbers, and shattering of marriages. The poet says, Beparda haseeno se hua tanga zamana. Wallah, the time and the era is frustrated with unveiled beautiful woman. Aankone shuru kar diya ab dil ko satana. Now the eyes started passing lustful gazes and messages to the heart. Then the poet goes on to say, Lekin agar aankon ko tu unse na bachaye. If you don't divert your gaze from the forbidden woman, don't even try to divert your thoughts. If you don't divert your eyes, don't even try. Inevitably your heart will be captured. The Nabi of Allah is sitting in i'tikaf. Safiya, his noble spouse and consort and wife, the mother of the entire ummah, comes and speaks to him, in confidentiality. Two sahaba happen to walk by. The Nabi of Allah tells them, Ala rislikuma, pause there, and then come back here. They came back. Nabi alayhi salam says, just for your information, I'm not speaking to a strange woman, I'm speaking to my own lawful legal wife. So they said, O Nabi of Allah, we will never harbor ill feelings against you. Nabi alayhi salam said, but I fear that if the devil has to inject something in your heart, your iman will be at stake. The Nabi of Allah was so conscious that this was a position of apparent accusation. We know the Nabi of Allah is divinely protected. What about those people that are sitting in their offices? On their right they are women, on their left they are women. The first harm, apart from the grave consequences in akhirat, Allah will divinely snatch the joy of your wife. You will look at your beautiful wife, but you will find no pleasure. When the Nabi of Allah went for Mi'raj and he ascended, and he came across a group of people who were sitting, who had a delicious meal before them, and on the other hand they had meat that was rotten, meat that was giving off an odor, and these people left eating this beautiful, delicious, well-cooked meat, and on the other hand they were eating meat that was rotten. So he asked Jibreel, who are these people? Jibreel said, this is that part of your ummah whom Allah has given a tasty, legal, lawful spouse and wife, but they leave them and they run behind women who have no morals, no values. Brothers, I was making mention, the Nabi of Allah said, Dayyuth. Who is a Dayyuth? A Dayyuth will never enter Jannah. Tell us, O Nabi of Allah, who is a Dayyuth? A cuckold. A cuckold is a Dayyuth. Who is a cuckold, O Nabi of Allah? Alladhi yadkhulu ala ahlihi ar-rijal. If you analyze the word cuckold from the English dictionary, it comes out from the word cuckoo. And they say a cuckoo, it is known of this bird, that it would leave its eggs to hatch in the nest of another bird. This is the condition of this man, who doesn't mind his wife speaking with strange men, who doesn't mind his wife entertaining strange men. Since when has this ummah lost its morals that you introduce your wife to a strange man? Wallah, brothers, my focus, as I said today, is not fornication that is forbidden and haram. I'm speaking about those married couples that are pursuing unlawful and illicit relations. The nature of a man was supposed to be such ghayur. Ghayur, sense of honor. Sa'd bin Ubadah radiallahu anhu said, O Nabi of Allah, if I come home and I must find my wife with a strange man, I make you my witness, I will strike that man with the sharp edge of my sword there and there. Sahaba looked at him. Nabi alayhi salam said, are you impressed at the sense of honor this man has? By Allah, I have a greater sense of honor. Wallah, you are possessive over your car, tomorrow you die and your car is gone. If there's anything you have to be possessive over, man, is your iman and your wife and your daughters. How can you be possessive over your car? What is that all about? Possessive, obsessed is your woman. But what do you want? Don't speak to my wife. Wallah, after you get married, you are responsible. You have to make her curtail ties with even those that are her relatives but form her na-mahram. That is not amongst her maharim. She cannot speak to them and you are responsible. The Nabi of Allah says you will be deprived of Jannah if you don't mind your wife pursuing unlawful relation. Of course, as a man, we have to discipline ourselves primarily. Let's take the incident of Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam. When you are talking of a sense of honor in a man, the pride of a man, the pride of a man, Allahu Akbar. When Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam is traveling with his wife Sarah alayhi salam, and they come into Egypt, فَدَخَلَ بِهَا قَرْيَةٌ مَلِكٌ مِّنَ الْمُلُوكِ أَوْ جَبَّارٌ مِّنَ الْجَبَابِرَةِ. And there's a tyrant ruler whose evil practice was, any couple traveling, he would kill the husband, abduct the woman, and satisfy his lust. As they came close to this town, this city, this country, immediately the sense of fear and the possessive nature over his wife created some concern within him. And if a man was traveling, husband and wife, brother and sister, then the king would not harass or interfere. So Ibrahim alayhi salam then tells, Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam then tells his wife that, look here, perhaps we'll have to present in the court of this tyrant ruler on an ambiguous term. I would say you are my sister, and Islamically you are my wife as well as my sister. So if he happens to ask you the relation between us two, then agree with what I say, that you are my sister. But this was a woman of morality. This was woman of chastity. As she comes close, the riwayat of Bukhari says, قامت, she stood up. Tawadda, she performed her wudu. Tusalli, she then performed salah. And then she came in front of this man, this tyrant, lustful gaze. How vulnerable the sister of today is. Wallah, we will live with less money, but we will not risk the honor of a woman in this vicious world where lustful gazes will be coming on her from every angle. Brothers, there is nothing there. Every woman that is going outside, look at what is the condition of her marriage at home. Anyway, as they come close, Allahu Akbar, she then makes dua to Allah. Allahumma in kuntu amantu bika wa bi rasulik. وأحسنت فرجي إلا على زوجي فلا تسلط علي هذا الكافر. Oh Allah, you know I brought iman on you and I brought iman on your Nabi. You very well know, O my Allah, I gave no male access to my private organ with the exception of my spouse. I ask you through the medium of the fidelity and the loyalty I have displayed to my partner that not this kafir even come close to me. Once upon a time, the woman of this ummah had something to present in the court of Allah. But on the contrary is the condition of my sister today, who deliberately presents herself, projects herself. My Nabi said in the riwayat of Muslim Sharif, أَيُّمَا امْرَأَةٍ وَضَعَتْ ثِيَابَهَا فِي غَيْرِ بَيْتِ زَوْجِهَا. That woman who takes out her clothes to present herself in any environment apart from that of her husband, she has broken the veil of Allah. Brothers, if she is a woman of chastity and morality, do you know Islam has not given this woman rights, Islam has given her heights. Islam has given her such heights that the Nabi of Allah says, if you accuse a chaste woman of zina, the riwayat of Tibrani, قَذْفُ الْمُحْسَنَاتِ يَهْدِمُ عَمَلَ مِئَةَ سَنَةٍ. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam says, accusing a chaste woman of zina destroys the piety of one century. Anyway, this woman comes in the court. After making dua to Allah, Allah, I gave no male access to my organ, my private, other than my husband. Do we know, brothers, why there is dowry? Just for our own information. When we give dowry, what is dowry all about? Dowry, in essence, is you are contracting with this woman with in a noble way that lifelong I will be benefiting from your organ to enjoy matrimonial relation with dignity and respect on the amount agreed. This money will be given to you and lifelong you will avail yourself. My Nabi said that husband who calls his wife, that husband who calls his wife, here again brothers, because that woman is not cherishing her motherhood, because she is not staying indoors, she is coming home tired and exhausted. The Nabi of Allah says, if you are outside, this is happening brothers, and you are attracted by a woman, immediately come home. These are the words of Nabi alayhi salam. فَإِنَّ مَعَهَا مِثْلَ الَّذِي مَعَهَا. Call your wife. Nabi alayhi salam says, if she's cooking a pot of food, tell her to leave the pot of food. If she's engaged in anything else, this is an overwhelming need in this man. Respond to the need of this man. If this woman will not comply, Nabi alayhi salam says, إِلَّا الَّذِي كَانَ فِي السَّمَاءِ سَاخِطًا عَلَيْهَا. Allah and His Malaika become angry with this woman. But of course, she will only able to comply if she doesn't have to go out in the commercial world. In the commercial world, my sister, you have no honor. You are so cheap that from a toothpick till a truck tire, to promote it, it is the image of one woman. That is how they have dropped her. That is how she's lost her honor, her integrity, her morality. But look at this woman. Oh Allah, I ask you through the medium of the fidelity that I displayed with my husband, let not this kafir come close. As she comes in the court, the kafir looked at her. It comes in the riwayat of Bukhari. He then stretched his hand before he could touch Sarah. Allah paralyzed his entire hand. Allah paralyzed it. Allah, if the woman has taqwa, that man who endeavors to cast a lustful gaze, Allah will snatch his sight. وَلَوْ نَشَاءُ لَتَمَسْنَا أَعْيُنَهُمْ. But she herself is presenting herself. She is projecting herself. Brothers, what a society, what an environment are we living in? The Nabi of Allah said, لَا يَزْنِ الزَّانِي حِينَ يَزْنِي وَهُوَ مُؤْمِنِ. It is so despicable, so detestable by Allah, that even iman cannot tolerate this action. Iman leaves that man that is in zina. Iman departs from him. Some muhaddithin say iman then shelters and hovers above his head. If he makes tawbah, iman comes back. But as long as he engages in zina, there's no iman in his life. In the other punishments, when the Quran speaks about the consequences of the other wrong, Allah Ta'ala says that tell the man to reform quietly, secretly. But when it comes to the act of zina, Allah says, "Azzaniyatu wazzani fajlidu kulla wahidin minhuma mi'ata jalda." Allah says, lash them. And just not let them ولا تأخذكم بهما رأفة في دين الله. Let not kindness overpower you in the implementation of the command of Allah. But rather kindness to this adulterer and adulteress is torture to the innocent people. How many sisters have lost their izzat because of such people? One side man says that you must institute the most severe crime for a child rapist. One side he wants to enjoy his freedom. Brothers, insan is confused. Pagal ki tarah chalte hain ushaq majazi, bechain hai din raat ye badnaam zamana. The poet says, like insane people, these fake lovers are moving around in this world. This world is corrupted. This world doesn't know where it's going, where is it coming. As long as you and I will digress. Allahu Akbar, the ulama have written, the very first crime, wherever Allah speaks about Maryam alayhi salam in the Quran, Allah couples it with her chastity. وَمَرْيَمَ بَنَتَ عِمْرَانَ الَّتِي أَحْسَنَتْ فَرْجَهَا. Maryam alayhi salam, that woman who safeguarded her chastity. Just recently it came to light, alhamdulillah, one woman in America, a revert who was fighting for her Islamic rights, to say that no, she has to veil herself even in her identity. And then you find articles that appear in yesterday's paper, the so-called intelligent thinkers of today that want to say that no, I studied the entire Quran. It doesn't appear in the Quran anywhere that a woman has to veil herself. Ya ukhti la tarfa'i anki al-khimara fatandami. Oh my sister, don't unveil yourself if you want to save yourself from the severe horror of the day of Qiyamah. Suni jamalaki, protect your beauty. Display it before your husband. She is displaying it at strange places. She is not ready for her own husband. And brothers, as I mentioned, ideally look after your one wife and enjoy the best of matrimonial relation. But if you are pursuing an illicit relation, either curtail that or take on that other nikah. It is unfortunate that our society today has stigmatized polygamy and has embraced zina. And the stigma doesn't only go to that man who takes on the second nikah. Allah forgive, Allah forbid. The stigma also goes on to that alim that is performing the nikah. Our society shuns a man who takes on another wife as though he has abandoned his faith and he has become murtad. Nevertheless, study the first crime that took place on the face of this earth was because of the crave of one woman. Don't underestimate the consequences of that evil thought that settles in your heart and your mind. Consult with the scholars. Make tawbah to Allah. As I mentioned, we have to adopt some measures. As a man, Allah has created you weak. I fail to comprehend when you know by your very nature you are flammable. How do you sit in the company of explosives? Wallah, brothers, I can't see concession. I'm talking about myself. Whenever I have to go shopping, in any environment, I will always tell my wife, come with me. The environment is so evil. The Sahabi comes to Nabi alayhi salam. The riwayat of Bukhari Sharif, Allah Ta'ala speaks about it in the Quran. وَاتِمِ الصَّلَاةَ تَرَفَيِ اللَّيْلِ وَاتِمِ الصَّلَاةَ تَرَفَيِ النَّهَارِ وَزُلَفًا مِّنَ اللَّيْلِ. O Nabi of Allah, I was engaging in transaction. A woman came to me, she asked me for dates. And I told her, I've got better dates in the house. And as she entered, I got overpowered. And somehow I couldn't resist myself. I fell on her and I kissed her, O Nabi of Allah. If this could happen in the golden era of prophethood, I can't see how you and I can be protected from this evil that is happening. Of course, we turn to Allah and we ask Allah. But we have to institute some practical measures. Number one, brothers, you know, when a man is traveling alone overseas for conference, you know, to travel alone without his wife or without a company, it is actually jeopardizing your vulnerability. You are risking yourself even more and more. In that incident where a person, Allahu Akbar, we don't have time. Let me mention what I was speaking about. The first sin that happened on the face of this earth was because of a woman. Habil and Qabil. What happened in essence, brothers? Habil's wife was more attractive, more beautiful than Qabil's wife. He could not accept, why does my brother have a more beautiful wife than I do? He says, at no cost am I going to accept this year. He then goes, the very first sin through which Allah was disobeyed, the first murder, the first unjust killing that took place on the face of this earth was because of this very same thing. He then comes to his brother. The Quran then discusses it in great detail. In the end, he could not accept that my brother has a more beautiful wife. فَطَوَّعَتْ لَهُ نَفْسُهُ قَتْلَ أَخِيهِ فَقَتْلَهُ. In the end, in the crave of getting this woman, his ego provoked him so much. The only way out is I kill my brother. He assassinated his brother in the crave of one woman. In the end, he also did not get that woman. The riwayat suggests Allah then changed his color and his complexion, and within 2 to 3 days he also died. He then carried the carcass of his brother moving around on this earth. فَبَعَثَ اللَّهُ غُرَابًا يَبْحَثُ فِي الْأَرْضِ لِيُرِيَهُ كَيْفَ يُوَارِي سَوْءَةَ أَخِيهِ. He didn't know how to dispose of the body of his brother, all in the grave of one woman. Take the incident of Salih alayhi salam. They told Salih, oh Salih, make dua to Allah that the mountain must split and a pregnant she camel must emerge and the camel must give birth. Salih alayhi salam made dua to Allah, إِن كُنْتَ صَادِقًا فَأَخْرِجْ لَنَا مِنْ هَذَا الْجَبَلِ نَاقَةً حَامِلًا. The mountain split, the pregnant camel came out, it gave birth. This camel was given the honor of being Naqatullah, the camel of Allah. تَأْكُلْ فِي أَرْضِ اللَّهِ. It will move freely on the earth of Allah, graze in the pastures of Allah, drink the water of Allah. Somehow the nation then became irritated with this camel. It used to, you know, consume a lot of water. So many other people felt that their animals were being deprived. Cutting a long story short, finally it was arranged that one day the camel will drink water, one day the animals of the locality will drink water. This continued for a period of time. But after a little while they felt that no, we must do away with this camel. Again in the lust of one woman, in the lust of one woman, a woman in Sirat Anbiya it is written, a woman by the name of Saduq, she presented herself before an immoral man by the name of Musadda. And some riwayat suggest a person by the name of Quddar bin Salif. He went to one prostitute and he says that I want to have access to you. This woman apparently had a lot of animals. She said, you kill that camel and you enjoy me. This man was now blinded by the love of this woman. The Quran said, إِذِن بَعَثَ أَشْقَاهَا. When the most wicked among them stood up, Salih alayhi salam told him, pause. If you kill this camel, there's nothing to stop you from the azab of Allah. But he was again influenced. He was overpowered by the pressure of this woman. He could not make heads or tails in his life. He wanted this woman and he goes and kills that camel. The Quran then makes mention, وَأَمَّا ثَمُودُ فَأَدَيْنَاهُمْ فَاسْتَحَبُّ الْعَمَى. That entire nation was then engulfed in the divine azab of Allah because of one man who killed this camel because of pursuing one woman. Brothers, wallahi, it has destroyed nations. We are living in a society, every day we are hearing of zina. Every day we are hearing of evil, evil things. As I mentioned in conclusion, one, two advisors. One of the best things out of personal experience I have mentioned is to help you lower your gaze is to read Quran in abundance. Make it a practice daily before leaving your house, read Quran. No man is pious, no man is intelligent. No man has matured the challenge of woman. Before leaving your house, read Quran. We learn in that riwayat where that person killed 100 people and he went to that pious man. The pious man told him, انطلق إلى أرض كذا وكذا فإن فيها أناس يعبدون الله فاعبد الله معهم ولا ترجع إلى أرضك فإنها أرض سوء. Don't return back to your place, that is a place of evil. You will once again be trapped up in the environment. Avoid the places of haram. Avoid congregating, converging at places where you know inevitably, brothers, you can't sit by fire and not feel hot. It is natural, it's automatic. Avoid such situations. If you are traveling in this world, travel with your wife. Be in the condition of wudu and recite Quran. Inshallah, if we will try, by virtue of that, Allah will safeguard our honor, our chastity. May Allah Ta'ala safeguard our children, those youth that are growing up in this environment. Oh Allah, safeguard their izzat. Oh Allah, instill izzat in our daughters and our sisters. We conclude with the dua of Nabi alayhi salam, where that young boy came and said, oh Nabi of Allah, permit me to make zina. Then the Nabi of Allah had a dialogue with him, and in the end, my Nabi held his hand. I swear by Allah, I make this dua daily. Brothers, let us take this dua to heart. Nabi alayhi salam took his blessed hand, placed it on the chest of this boy, and then Nabi alayhi salam said, Allahumma tahhir qalbahu, waghfir dhanbahu, wahassin farjahu. Oh Allah, pardon the sin of this boy. Oh Allah, clean the heart of this boy. Oh Allah, safeguard the chastity of this boy. Let us say ameen. Oh Allah, safeguard our chastity. Oh Allah, oh Allah, forgive our sins. Oh Allah, oh Allah, protect us from zina. My Nabi said, may yadhmanu li ma bayna lihyayhi wa ma bayna fakhidayhi. The young boy who can safeguard the flesh between his jaws and the flesh between his thighs, he can come. I will hold his hand and put him in Jannah. Allah inspire us all. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillah rabbil alamin.